All right, so the last topic in this already very long GAN lecture is on implementing a DC GAN for generating face images in PyTorch. And just when I looked at the paper again, actually, I just noticed it's also Sumit Chintala here, the author of the GAN tips and tricks that we discussed in the previous video. So essentially, the only thing that is different compared to our previous MNIST GAN is that the dataset is of course different, and that we are now using a convolutional GAN instead of fully connected layers. So let's go through this step by step. Again, our boilerplate here. Again, notice we have two learning rates like before. Now we have SYLAB A dataset instead of MNIST. And here's an example of some of the images, how they look like. So it's an image dataset consisting of celebrities collected from Google, I think, from the Google image search. So and this is our deep convolutional GAN here. It's lots of layers for the generator, the conf transpose layers, because we go from lane dimension by default 100, so a 100 dimensional noise vector. We go up, sample it up, so that it has 64 times 64 dimensional. So I should mention I resized, if I go back up again, I resized the images here. So I first cropped them and then I resized them to 64 times 64. It's easier to train again with smaller images. Of course, there are GANs with bigger images. And if you look, there are multiple approaches to that. Some people train the GAN still on lower images and then use super resolution methods. Some others do that directly. But yes, you can see these have much higher quality. It's just hard to do that, and especially with a regular GAN. So there are many advanced GANs which we can't all cover in this class. But for a regular convolutional GAN like this one, it's easier to work with smaller image sizes. It also depends really on how large your data set is, how many images you have, how diverse the images are in terms of colors and view angles and things like that. Many, many factors to consider. So here I found 64 times 64 worked much better than 128 times 128, for example. Okay, so here's just a snapshot of some randomly sample people, and then here our generator again. So here I'm alternating between transpose convolution or just transpose convolution. I don't use any pooling or something like that. It's just, or no upsampling, it's just transpose convolution for making it larger. Then batch norm, leaky relu, transpose, batch norm, leaky relu, same thing, and then the last one with the 10H function here, so that we get -1 and 1 pixel ranges. And the discriminator is a little bit, not that much simpler, but maybe it's a little bit too big. It's also one aspect of the discriminator is too good that it's also then challenging for the generator. So they could have been a little bit too big, but it happened to work. So here the discriminator has a convolutional layer, leaky relu, convolutional layer, batch norm, leaky relu, and so forth. So I'm downsampling with the convolution here instead of using max pooling. In the end there's a flatten to get from, so we don't use any fully connected layer. So here this is similar to what we discussed in the convolutional lecture when we said we can actually get rid of the last fully connected layer if we make the dimensions so such here. If I have 64 times 64 inputs, at this point when you do the math you will have 4 times 4 feature maps, and then I'm applying a convolutional layer with kernel size 4, so from 4 to 4 it will go to 1 to 1, and then I go from 8 channels to 1 channel, so the output will be a 1 by 1 by 1 tensor, and then I'm flattening it into a single value, which is my probability that this is a real image, because we are using binary cross entropy. And this looks like before, a little bit simpler now compared to our MNIST GAN, because I wrote all the training function such that it works with images, and then when I had my MNIST GAN I had to adjust a little bit to do the reshaping, because a fully connected layer works with vectors, not with images, right? So I had to just do this back and forth here to make it work with my training code. But you could also always write more elegant training code to have an if-else statement, whether it's a convolution layer or fully connected layer. But I didn't do that much work because I felt like the code is already complicated enough, hard to read already. Okay, so I'm using Atom again for both. I tried using SGD for the discriminator, but it didn't work so well. It requires also more learning rate tuning, and already took me a long time to get this running well. So here's my training function, the same as before. We can take a look at this again if you like. I mean, there's nothing new, so nothing has changed. But there was one thing I wanted to discuss briefly. So one thing I was wondering when I was going over the tips in the previous video, that I was thinking of one additional tip, that is whether we should sample the noise separately for the discriminator and the generator. So here I'm getting the generated fake images. I was wondering, so here I'm using them again. Here I'm using them for the discriminator, and here for the generator I'm using them again. So I was wondering, instead of having the noise here, like for the discriminator and the generator, we could maybe have, so it's probably clearer if I put it here, we could have it here, fake images for the discriminator, but then use different ones for fooling the discriminator. I find this is maybe also an interesting thing to try out. Actually, I haven't tried this. I could run this and see if it performs better, because the rationale could be here we are training the discriminator to recognize these images as fake here, and then we are training the generator to basically fool the discriminator with these images. But I'm wondering if it's just back and forth because we use the same batch, or whether it might be better to use a fresh batch. So instead of using the same one for both, having these two different ones might be another trick to try. I haven't tried this, might be something else to consider. Maybe it doesn't make a difference, I don't know. Okay, so but except that, the whole training function is still the same. Going back to my code, this one, so training it, and see, kind of stays okay, so nothing, so the discriminator doesn't go to zero, which is bad, or yeah, zero loss for the discriminator means it's way too good. And nothing unusual, so it's training for a long time, 20 epochs, sorry, 1 hour almost. I mean, for the grand scheme of things, for deep learning, it's actually pretty fast, but if you try to code the lecture so that I can talk about it, I was like, yeah, a little bit under time constraints. I was happy that it finished so fast because I also had to try different hyperparameters. Yes, so it's a lot of work actually to do these codes. So I talked to some people during office hours, and some students said it's kind of takes a long time to work on the project. But yeah, I can totally understand you, because also for research or these even these simple class examples, it takes a long time. It's just the nature of deep learning. So yeah, plotting things, I can see that's interesting. The generator goes up, the discriminator is kind of low here, actually, to be honest, it's approaching zero. But when I look at the results, they looked actually quite reasonable. So first epoch, you can see these don't really look like face images, but as we go further, epoch 5, epoch 10, so not all of them look realistic, but this person, maybe this person, yeah, to some extent, start looking more realistic. I mean, of course, you can see they are generated, they're not that great, but they're also not terrible, right? So yeah, could be better, the results could be better. So this person looks kind of realistic. But yeah, given that this is a very simple code, I only trained 20 epochs, it doesn't look too terrible in my opinion. Actually, just wanted to show you one that actually failed. So the difference between the one I just showed you and this one is only that here I initially had a regular ReLU, and when I trained it with a regular ReLU, it was first going fine, and then we had this huge spike here, and then suddenly things looked very different. And now looking at the results, first it looks the same as before, right? Looks okay-ish, but then it suddenly there's some mode collapse or something like that. You can see they all look the same. So it looks like mode collapse, where the discriminator can be easily probably fooled by the generator or something like that. The generator is also very noisy. It generates the same type of image, kind of. So yeah, that was also interesting. Okay, so that is the deep convolution again. It's overall, if you look at the code, it's a pretty complicated topic, right? We have a lot of training code, but that's just the nature of deep learning. To be honest, it also takes me time to write this, but I remember when I was a student, when this was all kind of new back then, I didn't learn this actually in class because I was finished with classes when GANs came out, but I was reading the paper, looking at some early code examples. I think it was Theano. Back in the day, code was much harder to read compared to PyTorch, and it also took me a long time to kind of figure out how the code works. Now it's for me easier. I can write these things myself, but I would say it's still one of the more complicated models compared to, let's say, classifiers. So if this looks all complicated to you, you just need to give it some time. You have to maybe implement it yourself or take some code, modify it a little bit, maybe apply some of the tricks. So you could, for instance, apply the trick where you flip the labels for the discriminator or occasionally and just get a better feeling for the code and where things are. And then with some time, you will also become pretty confident reading code. But it really takes time. So I can imagine just taking one class is not enough to really get confident doing this. It takes probably years. And what's very important is really working on the projects where you just work by yourself. Not totally by yourself. You have your team. You can ask me for feedback. There are many students or several students in office hours where I usually help with the coding parts if there are errors. But ultimately, you need to spend time with the code. There's no kind of textbook or anything like that that helps you really understanding everything. It is really through interaction, most of it, and also doing some search on the internet, and this is how everyone who's doing coding learns. It's a process. It takes practice. All right, so with that, let me then end this already long lecture on generative adversarial networks.